The JT Show, Super Talk Mississippi, and joining us now on the guest line, and I'm getting right to him because I suspect he doesn't have very long, your 4th District Congressman, Stephen Palazzo. Stephen, how you doing?
Hey, Dave, I'm doing great. I have as much time as you want me on today. How's that sound? So,
what that tells me is you have other things you don't want to be doing.
Though.
Yeah. I'm getting you out of something. That's what it sounds like.
It's hot. It's hot outside. So if I could come in and get some air conditioning and talk to you and others, I say let's do it.
Well, the congressman
we'll milk as much as we can.
Yeah, congressman will be on with us for the rest of the show. He'll be on Good Things. He may be on Sports Talk to talk some sport. You know, we're just going to keep him for the day at this point. And for those that don't know why we're joking about this, you're doing a different kind of duty for your country aside from your congressman duties. You are doing your training with the National Guard this week, right?
That's correct. I'm actually into my second week, and I'm doing my annual training at Camp Shelby, which, by the way, is one of the finest, not best, the National Guard training sites in America. And, you know, and as always, the people are its greatest asset, and they're just out there every day providing for the common defense of our nation. If you never had a chance to come visit Camp Shelby, I strongly encourage you to do so. And it also has a museum, a military museum that is second to none. If you've been to the World War II Museum in New Orleans, you will really appreciate what they have here at Camp Shelby. And right now, in full disclosure, I am taking my lunch break, and I'm in my office in downtown Hattiesburg.
Okay, so you're hiding.
I'm on lunch break.
That's a nice way to put it. You're on lunch break. Yeah. I get that. Well, in the middle of all this, you've still got stuff going on in Washington that your congressional duties. I don't know how you're juggling both of them at the same time. It's got to be a pretty complicated trick, I would think.
Yeah, well, you know, I do set aside time for my annual training, and it's also, you know, coincides with the August recess, which is somewhat of a, you know, take a break from Congress in terms of being in D.C. and working. But as we know, you know, Speaker Pelosi has not really wanted to call Congress into session and do the nation's business. I don't know if she's using the coronavirus as an excuse, or she just doesn't want the American people to realize they don't have a plan for our nation. And what we have seen is a huge contrast in what the Republicans have been doing. You know, we've been pushing, you know, we want to renew the American dream. We want to restore our way of life, and we want to rebuild our economy and make it hotter and greater than it was just 6 months ago. And they want to burn down cities and defund the police. I just don't think that's a selling message going into the November election.
Well, and I think, you know, not trying to make excuses for her, but she couldn't call, you know, you guys back into session. She had a hair appointment.
Yeah, you sure wasn't a seance or yeah. Okay, well, I understand. She has her priorities straight. They're just not the same priorities as the American people.
Well, and she puts it on display. You know, I don't think she meant to this time, but it still came out. But it really underlines part of the problem that we have, and it really, to me, illustrates the fact that a lot of this is just a political show in terms of the delay, in terms of the arguments and the negotiating back and forth and everything else, and it's not really aligning with, to use a flowery phrase, what's in her heart and a lot of the other Democratic House members' hearts.
Yeah, it's definitely a political show, and what she's doing, not wanting to reach out and work with the president. You know, president wants to work with Speaker Pelosi in the House, and as he's worked with the Senate, you know, he wants to, you know, take care of the American people, and so she's actually putting these games ahead of caring for her own constituents and caring for Americans. But it shouldn't surprise anybody. You know, they pick illegal aliens over the American worker. They pick foreign despots over our foreign allies and friends. And again, it's just, you know, it's somewhat, you know, it's sad that every 4 years, instead of, you know, it's okay, I get it, it's presidential politics, but at the same time, we have to find common ground and come together, and that's the only way that we're going to make America stronger. But if they continue to try to divide us based on identity politics and all these manufactured crises, it's going to backfire on them, but two, it's really harming the psyche of America.
Let me ask you this, looping back around to what we talked about first, but it all ties in together. The entire pandemic situation, COVID-19, is that having any impact on the way training is being done with the National Guard at Camp Shelby?
No, well, they're doing a great job of masking up. You know, I mean, these are, you know, they're frontline. We ask them to go do things during natural disasters, man-made disasters, and wars. And Shelby's, I guess soldiers are just, you know, we're a little more disciplined than the general public, so we're used to taking orders. But they do require everybody to have their temp checks, mask, in a series of questions. But no, they're working hard. I mean, they have a mission to train, and you know, National Guardsmen from all over the country that come in here. They need that training because the one thing that we cannot allow to erode during this COVID-19 pandemic is our readiness, because you know we have foreign adversaries that are loving the fact that our country's divided right now under, you know, due to politics, but they're also probing us for weaknesses, and whether it's cyber, whether it's air, space, or land or sea, they're looking to see how we react to this. And for the best part of it, I think the military has done a really good job of not allowing their defense down, and I think our enemies probably have noticed that.
Now, the big topic tying into COVID-19 across the board is another round of stimulus. Is there any chance of anybody coming to an agreement on this?
That's a great question. That's a Powerball number pick right there. they want $3.5 trillion. They said they would, you know, back off what, a half a trillion. We had proposed $1 trillion, and I think now we have even less. We proposed $500 billion, but it's so strategic. It's targeted for those who are hurting the most because of the shelter in place, because of the forced shutdowns, and it's just, you know, the industries that are vital, such as small businesses as well as critical industries that we need to make sure that they don't go out of business, that they can recover fast. So the president and the Senate Republicans and the House Republicans, we would love to sit down with Nancy Pelosi and the radical left and say, look, how do we help Americans? How do we provide the strategic, highly targeted relief? Because this is money we don't have. And I hope, you know, in trying to, you know, prop up or find a cure for COVID through financial stimuluses and packages, we may be doing more harm to our country by just borrowing money that we can't afford to pay back. And that could very well harm future generations of Americans trying to tackle what we have today. So, you know, look, theirs was a $3.5 trillion giveaway. Again, money we don't have, and our plan is to target those who are in the most need of these resources, and we're ready to work with her. But once again, Nancy Pelosi and the radical left are putting politics over good policy and the people of the United States.
Well, and that's one thing that I've noticed, because they're sounding the gong repeatedly that, you know, it's the Republicans that won't negotiate. We've come down a couple of times, and I'm thinking, yeah, but you still have the allocation to save the habitat of the naked screech owl, woven into this, and it has nothing to do with what we're talking about. We saw that with the last stimulus package, where they had just some ludicrous things that went in there, and that, to me, sitting here in the cheap seats, is the sticking point on this. You got to strip all of that out.
Yeah, I think we could start from scratch and identify, and we have the data now. We know what programs are working, what programs didn't work. We know how to, you know, be efficient and effective in the delivery of some very tight resources. I agree with you, but you got, you know, also in their $3.5 trillion package, the word cannabis was used more than the word coronavirus. So that tells you where their priorities are, and it's not looking out after the best interests of America.
Apparently, it's on weed.
It's all weed, yeah. Of course, and they're on weed.
Of course, you know, if you smoke a lot of weed, you get the munchies. That's why you sometimes have to have a refrigerator full of ice cream. We're on the air with 4th District Congressman Stephen Bly. I'm full of cheap shots today, Stephen. I can't help it.
It's okay.
We're on the air with Stephen Palazzo, 4th District Congressman. He's on the guest line, and we will continue with him next on the JT Show. Super Talk Mississippi, the JT Show on the guest line. Congressman Stephen Palazzo. And I want to ask you about something. I know you're excited about this, and you're proud of this, and I want to give you a chance to explain what it is and hype it up a bit. Tell us what Academy Day is.
Oh, yeah. Great, man. Dave, that's so every year we do an Academy Day. We have 5 academies in our nation representing all the major armed services. And typically we would do that in October time frame, September, October time frame, and we'd have actual cadets from the academies come down, and we put anywhere from 40 to 120 high school students in a room with them. And, you know, last year we had a great keynote with Commander Heather Blackwell from Keesler Air Force Base. She's also an Academy grad, came and spoke. And, you know, it just gives these young individuals who has a deep desire to serve an opportunity to have one-on-one with the academies themselves to see what's best for them, and also to maybe help mentor them to actually achieve their dream. But because of COVID, and we're taking, you know, all this seriously, we're doing our social distancing, we're masking up Mississippi, we're doing it virtually, and it's going to be on September 12th. It's going to be virtual. We're going to have representatives from all the academies, and I believe what's special this year, and I'd have to go back, I think we're doing this jointly with the other members of Congress. So it's not just going to be my Academy Day. I think this is going to be Mississippi's Academy Day, and I think I'm going to be joined by my colleagues from the other part of the state. I'm not 100% sure, but if anybody is interested, they can go to our website and RSVP. And again, our website simple is plazo.house.gov, and you know, you'll find out about all the academies and get more details on our virtual Academy Day, which is coming up on September the 12th.
And a lot of times people don't, to me, especially the kids where it should be focused, a lot of people just kind of forget about the academies. You know, you're supposed to just, you know, go sign up, enlist, and you go off to basic, and that's the way it works. There's a lot more there and a lot more opportunity there as well. And that's why I think Academy Day is a great idea, because it gets that word out.
Yeah, the academies are, it's like winning the golden ticket in a Willy Wonka chocolate bar. It is highly competitive, but if people put their minds to it and they start, you know, early enough, 10th or 11th grade, and look, we've actually had 12, you know, people in junior college come in and apply and get accepted. And it's just a total, you know, it's about academics. It's about athletics. It's about community service. It's about the whole person. And if you want to serve and you have a desire to serve, it's a 5-year commitment. I strongly encourage everyone to just at least tune in and see what it has. I personally joined the Marine Corps right out of high school. After a semester at Mississippi State, I decided that, you know, if I don't do it now, I'll never do it. And so I woke up on a bus and getting yelled at and told to jump on these yellow footprints in Paris Island. And I really wasn't until probably 20, I was working offshore. I called my dad one day from Morgan City, and he goes, "Son, you know, you ever think about doing the academies?" And I'm like, "What are you talking about?" and he told me, and he put me in touch, and they asked about an ACT score and some other stuff, and I just say, "Look, I'm too old and too late, but if I can help other young people, you know, just be knowledgeable about the process, I think it's worth it. It's great, and these men and women go on to be our leaders of our nation's military, and they're just fantastic."
Well, and I want to read something off the C Spire text line. Tiffany and Carrollton just texted this in, and I think everybody would agree with this and second it. She just says, "Tell Stephen thanks for his service."
Oh, wow. That's beautiful. Thank you. Tiffany, right? In Carrollton?
Yes.
That's really nice. And I do the same thing. It's like anytime I see people and I urge others, especially during Veterans Day's events, you know, veterans don't ask and military don't ask for much, but that thank you, just a simple thank you is huge and it's powerful. So thank you for that.
Well, and it's something that deserves thanks because, you know, you sacrifice a big chunk of your life. It's your family sacrifices, everybody involved sacrifices to help protect this country. So if anything in this mixed up world that we're living in the year 2020 deserves thanks, Stephen, to me, it's that 100%. So I'm going to second Tiffany. Thank you for your service.
Yeah, well, Dave, if I might add, you know, today's the 75th anniversary of the surrender of the Japanese at Pearl Harbor on the USS Missouri, and you know, it's the Greatest Generation to the Korean War to our Vietnam. You know, this past year was the actual 50th anniversary of the end of hostilities in Vietnam, and those are the true men and women who need a thank you, because, you know, they came back to a thankless nation, and we've been doing everything we can to make up for that, because they answered their nation's call to war. It wasn't a war that they chose, but they were chosen to fight it. And so that if you ever get a chance, just again, you know, our Vietnam veterans, they were highly mistreated, and those same Vietnam veterans made sure, when I came back from the Persian Gulf War after serving in Desert Shield and Desert Storm, they made sure that would never happen again. And that's where thank you for your service became a part of thanking our men and women in uniform again. And it's because of our Vietnam veterans would not allow this nation to be thankless again. And I think we were looking for that opportunity as a nation to make up for what we did to our Vietnam veterans.
Well, and, you know, it makes sense that they would be the ones to start that movement up, because they knew what it was like to get off that plane and walk through, at best, an empty field and airport, or at worst, with people there booing them and calling them names and everything else. They know what it's like when it's not that way, and they know how important it is to the men and women that are coming home, and that are, even if it's just coming home from training like you're doing this week at Camp Shelby, that's still a couple of weeks you're gone. And as a result, there's still some sacrifice even then, much less at war. So thanks are always, I think, on the table. Darren and Jackson on the ceasefire text line says, thank you, Stephen, for your service. I'm a Navy veteran. You know the Marines babysitters?
And you don't want to get Marines and sailors chatting back and forth on an open mic. But my dad and my brother were in the Navy. And you know what I like to remind people, and the Navy likes to remind us, that, hey, don't forget, you know, the Marines are a department of the Navy. And we like to remind them, yes, we're the men's department.
We really, at this point, ought to just patch you and Darren in and sit back and listen for the next half hour. It would be a good use of time.
Yeah, well, I appreciate that. Thanks, Darren.
Man. Well, you got
a
lot
going on. Since I had a chance to use that.
That's a good one. That's a very good one, Stephen. You got a lot going on at any minute. What happens, by the way, if Pelosi's hair is finally fixed properly and she has to get out for more ice cream anyway and decides to call the House back in session while you're at training? What happens?
I'll go back to Washington, D.C., and we'll just have to, I'm assuming that's never happened before, and we'll just have to adjust my orders, and I'll fulfill my military commitment when I'm able to return back home. So, but it should be wrapped up on September 7th, and I don't think Pelosi can think or move that fast, but hey, she may surprise us.
Yeah, well, it depends on if she sees a target of opportunity she can twist to her own ends. We're familiar with how she operates by now.
Yeah. We absolutely are. And, you know, she was out there, you know, giving Joe Biden advice about not debating the president. You know, if she's so clued in, why doesn't she debate the president of the United States? I'd love to see Pelosi and Trump on stage. And but anyway, that's just Yeah.
Well, and here's the thing.
It's not going to happen.
Well, if we would do that and put it on pay-per-view, it wouldn't matter what the amount on the stimulus package was because we could pay for it.
That's true. And we might be able to pay for the wall because nobody's watching professional sports anymore. So, I think it'd be a huge attraction.
I have some bad news for you, Congressman.
I got to go back to work.
Yeah, you got to go back to work. I can't give you an excuse anymore. You know, we're done.
Well, thank you. And real quick, I enjoyed hearing JT on the show today. You know, my hearts and prayers is still with him and his family. And if there's anything we can ever do, please don't hesitate to reach out to help the TeleSouth family.
We appreciate it very much. Congressman Stephen Palazzo, get back to work. You haven't sweated in half an hour, man. Come on.
All right, sir. Going back to work.
You have a good day, and thank you again for what you're doing for us. We appreciate it more than you can.